if this is the best way by which we can reach to any of our student, or any student can reach to any of their experts in this online model. So without wasting much time, let us start a mammoth task, that is radiotherapy in head and neck cancer. It's a very difficult topic, very vast topic, and it's very difficult to accommodate everything in just 1 hour. So anyway, we have subsequent classes as well, and each classes is dedicated for each subsite. So I'll talk about mostly on overview of radiotherapy in head and neck cancer in next 1 hour.
Can you please make the presentation full screen?
Yeah, I'll do that. So is it fine now?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay. So that's why I have made this more generalized. And today, basically, I'll tell you about the indications of radiotherapy, little bit about dose and fractionation, little bit about concurrent schedules, because we have a dedicated chemotherapy classes as well. We'll concentrate on management of neck at some point of time. We'll talk about few about morbidity, advanced radiotherapy techniques. Re-radiation, I'll not discuss today because there is a separate class by Dr. Sarvani, and various other aspects of head and neck radiotherapy. And all the data that I'll tell you, it's based on the evidence, and mostly based on the level 1 or level 2 evidences. So whenever we think about head and neck cancer, and we think about radiotherapy in head and neck cancer, so always there is a kind of balance between tumor control and toxicity, because we know when you try to improve tumor control by increasing the dose of radiotherapy or addition of chemotherapy or addition of some other agents with radiotherapy, there is some compromise in toxicity or compromise in organ at risk. So it's a very challenging task to balance tumor control and toxicity in most of the situations. So in radiation oncologist, as per radiation oncologist perspective, when we talk about tumor control, so it's actually depends on various aspects of dose, fractionation, radiosensitivity, addition of radiosensitizer, overall treatment time, what are the types of tumor that we are addressing, and definitely the stage of the tumor. And similarly, these are the same indicators for the toxicity as well, because it depends on the volume, it depends on the type and the site, overall treatment time, addition of radiosensitizer. So sometimes we also compromise with the toxicity. So before going for radiotherapy, I just want to give you key updates on HCC 8 staging. I'm not telling it in details because this is not part of our discussion today. So we have already restaged pharynx cancers based on 3 subgroups, that is nasopharynx, whether it's a EBV positive or EBV negative. We have subgrouped oropharynx and hypopharynx as HPV negative and HPV positive oropharynx. We have entire new staging paradigm for HPV positive associated oropharyngeal cancer. And new updates we get for oral cavity based on the depth, nasopharynx, cutaneous, SCC, and thyroid cancer. And we expanded our staging for nodal disease in view of presence of whether extranodal extension is there or not. So if you look at the nasopharynx, previously it was T4, lateral pterygoid involvement. Now it is T2. Involvement of prevertebral muscles was T4, but now it is T2. So that's why now our treatment approaches also has modified based on this staging system. When we talk about HPV negative oropharyngeal cancer, like T4 disease, we always talk about T4A and T4B. But when we talk about HPV positive, there is only T4, there is no T4A or T4B disease. In clinical end staging also, we say N1, N2 and N3, but when we do pathological end stage in OP, oral oropharyngeal cancer, it is N1 and N2, the metastasis 4 or fewer lymph nodes or metastasis more than 4 lymph nodes. And when we look at the staging system, there is no stage 4 in HPV positive oropharyngeal locally advanced cancer. So all are stage 3. Only stage 4 is when there is M1 disease. So these are important. And for HPV positive oropharyngeal cancer in staging, we know that we have changed it. So if it is less than 6 centimeter size, regardless of number, it had similar impact on survival. So these are clubbed together as N1. If it is bilateral, considered as N2. And if it more than 6 centimeter, it has worse survival and considered as N3. But whether is it a complete staging system? Probably not. I'm giving you two examples. So nowadays, various centers, actually, they are using nomograms instead of TNM classification. I'm giving you one example. It's a 60-year-old male smoker, smokes 20 pack a year, diabetic, chronic heart disease, maximum tumor dimension was 3.5 centimeter, depth was 0.7 centimeter, but has positive margin after surgery. LVE was positive, PNI was positive, and was positive level 2 node without PNE or extranodal extension. As per the TNM staging, it is T2, N1, M0. So as per T2, N1, M0, expected 5-year survival is 34%. Now, when we look at the nomogram, where they have included age, tobacco usage, maximum dimension, depth of invasion, site, margin, vascular invasion, perineural invasion, you see that as per the nomogram, 5-year survival is only 10%. So it's not matching. On the same, similarly, let us see another patient. It's a 30-year female non-smoker, no comorbidity, maximum tumor dimension is 2.5 centimeter. Depth is 0.7 centimeter, has negative margin, LVE negative, PNI negative, and positive level 2 node without PNE. So this is also T2, N1, M0 as per TNM. And you look at the expected survival as per TNM, it is 34% at 5 years. But if you look at the nomogram, 5-year survival is 80%. So still, TNM classification is not complete, and there are a lot of modifications which are coming in next TNM as well. So we can discuss TNM for another one day, or it will take another probably 1 hour if we stay on discussing it. So let us move towards the radiotherapy. What is our primary aim today? So radiotherapy in head and neck cancer, usually we can offer by either radical brachytherapy or radical external beam radiotherapy, or we can combine external beam radiotherapy with brachytherapy, radical chemo radiotherapy, and there are options for palliative radiotherapy. Let us see about this small lesion of a lip, 2.5 centimeter. There is no palpable neck node. So we have two options. One, either we can go for surgery. So it's a big surgery with a flap reconstruction, or we can think of doing brachytherapy in these cases. So if you look at the brachytherapy, 5-year control rate in well-selected patients is about 90 to 95%. Though there is no head-to-head comparison between EBRT with brachytherapy or EBRT or brachytherapy with surgery in these kind of cases, but the retrospective data we have, we can say if we choose a brachytherapy properly, we can achieve as good response and local control as that of surgery or external beam radiotherapy. So brachytherapy in head and neck is popular because head and neck cancers are easily accessible. And we can generate better dose profile with the brachytherapy. And we can robustly spare adjacent normal tissue. It has a rapid fall off. And one of the most important advantage of brachytherapy has it has very short overall treatment duration. And we can actually restore the organ function and cosmesis with brachytherapy. But there are limitations. We cannot do brachytherapy in all cases because large tumors, those tumors are very close to some important organs like mandible. We cannot do brachytherapy in those cases. And there are several tumors where the nodal involvement is very high. So there only doing local therapy or local brachytherapy is not enough to control the tumor locoregionally. So decision whether to go for radiotherapy or whether to go for surgery, whether to go for brachytherapy, it's a multidisciplinary decision. So it consists radiation oncologist, radiologist, head and neck surgeon, physicist, anesthetist, as well as a medical oncologist. And sometimes we use brachytherapy in recurrent disease as well. We use brachytherapy as a boost after radiotherapy as well. So to select a patient for brachytherapy, we always assess the risk-benefit ratio. So risk and benefit, these are based on several patient-related factors, whether patient is fit for brachytherapy, whether patient is fit for anesthesia. There are several disease-related factors, whether the disease site, location, size is appropriate for brachytherapy or not. And the last and most important thing, whether the expertise is available at your center for doing brachytherapy. Because we know that if we do a bad brachytherapy, probably that is more detrimental than doing a bad external beam radiotherapy. And there are several types of implants that we can offer, that permanent or temporary implants. And usually these are the selection criteria, that easily accessible lesions, early stage disease, localized tumor, no nodal involvement, no local infection, no comorbidities. Usually proliferative lesions are preferred. Preferred histology is squamous cell carcinoma, because most of the studies have been done on squamous cell carcinoma, especially for head and neck cancer. Mostly nowadays we use high dose rate brachytherapy. We use intraoperative brachytherapy in some cases, especially in recurrent cases, like in recurrent neck nodal involvement. We, after removal of node, we can do brachytherapy to radiate the nodal bed. Most commonest head neck tumor that we do brachytherapy is lip, because it's very easily doable, and we can achieve very excellent cosmesis with the lip brachytherapy. In oral tongue, brachytherapy usually not indicated. It is indicated only in very early superficial lesion, because we know if the depth is more than 4 millimeter, there is higher chance of neck nodal involvement. In those cases, usually we prefer surgery, and we sometimes we combine EBRT with brachytherapy to irradiate the neck. Buccal mucosa is doable, so we have a separate class on brachytherapy. That's why I am not telling you in details about brachytherapy. And usually the dose is delivered for a radical treatment is about 60 gray LDR equivalent. Sometimes we use brachytherapy tumor by mold brachytherapy. This case on left hand side, the superficial tumor, it is suitable for brachytherapy, but this kind of proliferative tumor is not suitable for brachytherapy. This is one of our case after before brachytherapy, and this is on follow up. This is another case of basal cell carcinoma, and this patient had undergone surface mold. You can use anything to provide surface dose by using like Orfit, with the wax mold, you can actually deliver a good conformal radiotherapy in these kind of cases where you cannot do surgery due to medical morbidity, or you cannot do radiotherapy, external beam radiotherapy, because of toxicity. External auditory canal is another area where for superficial tumor we can do brachytherapy. Nasopharynx, usually we do not do brachytherapy. We consider brachytherapy mainly in recurrent disease or if there is small residual disease after chemoradiotherapy. And there are two options. Either we can do it with intracavitary or interstitial implant. In intracavitary, there is a Rotterdam applicator, which is very popular for doing nasopharyngeal brachytherapy. Oropharynx, radical implant, usually we don't prefer doing radical brachytherapy for oropharynx, except for very early tonsillar lesion. It is usually combined with external beam radiotherapy as a boost. So these are a few cases of oropharynx being done. This is one trial is going on in TMH by Dr. Professor Ashwini Budrukkar. She will take your brachytherapy class. So it's a randomized trial. They are randomized IMRT radical radiotherapy with IMRT plus interstitial brachytherapy, and to see the whether addition of brachytherapy and reduction of external beam radiotherapy can reduce xerostomia by 25%. Adjuvant brachytherapy usually not popular, and salvage, yes, it is suitable in some cases. And if you look at the outcome rate in therapy, so it's between the local control rate is about 70 to 95% in 3 years. So brachytherapy in head and neck cancer, it's a multidisciplinary approach. Always remember about risk-benefit ratio. It has got excellent normal tissue sparing. Integral dose is less compared to other form of radiotherapy. It has high biological efficacy. It has decreased risk of tumor population because overall treatment time is very less. So doing brachytherapy, we actually eliminating errors. And that's why there is no need of giving a PTM margin over and above CTV. And it has got equivalent control result compared to other modalities. Definitely, it has better cosmesis. It has a potential of organ preservation. And it has a potential to for re-radiation as well. When we look at external beam radiotherapy techniques for last 20 to 30 years, we have seen immense development in radiotherapy techniques from conventional 3D CRT to IMRT to image-guided radiotherapy, proton heavy ions. So there is a lot of technological advancement. If you look at the dosimetric benefit, there are some dosimetric benefits. But if you look at the clinical benefit, there are few clinical benefits. So it is also important to understand, especially in high volume centers, when should we go for very high-end techniques and when we should go for a conventional radiotherapy or 3D radiotherapy techniques. So before going for a radical radiotherapy techniques, so I am giving you a few, there are a few slides on adjuvant radiotherapy, because we have another class on adjuvant radiotherapy. But for oral cavity cancers, especially tongue, buccal mucosa, so usually nowadays we prefer surgery more than brachytherapy, because while doing brachytherapy, probably we don't get few informations like depth of invasion, whether other deep muscles are involved. So it's not always suitable to do radical brachytherapy in these cases. So we usually see more of cases for adjuvant radiotherapy. So for adjuvant radiotherapy, we know the T stages, if it is higher, like T3 or T4, depth is higher for oral cavity cancer, more than 5 millimeter. If nodes are positive, these are the indications for giving adjuvant radiotherapy. If there is positive surgical margins, so if there is margin is closed, so how do we define as a closed margin? Conventionally, we say that if margin is less than 5 millimeter, that should be considered as a closed margin. But now in the era of robotic surgery, now they are doing transoral robotic surgery for oropharyngeal cancers as well. So while doing oropharyngeal cancer surgery, it is important to preserve the sphincters and the muscles for dysphagia. So these muscles, when they preserve, they actually leave behind only around 1 millimeter margin. So for these kind of cases, even 1 to 2 millimeters margins can be considered as adequate. So we also see whether any extracapsular extension is there, whether LVI is there, whether PNI is there, more than one lymph nodes are positive. If nodal diameter is more than 3 centimeter, there is higher chance of having extranodal extension. These are the indications for doing adjuvant radiotherapy. And sometimes we consider adjuvant radiotherapy in recurrent disease when there is no history, previous history of radiotherapy. So all the retrospective data, those data suggest that we should deliver at least around 60 gray for adjuvant radiotherapy when there is margin is negative. If margin is positive, then we have to deliver radical dose to 66 to 70 gray. If we have seen the there is no dose response relationship between 57.6 gray, except those patients with extranodal extension where dose till 63 gray have been shown better local locoregional control. So in those cases, we give up to 66 gray. And it is important to understand our overall treatment time, because we should not go beyond 8 weeks of overall treatment time, because that is also associated with detrimental outcome. And we should start adjuvant therapy much before 6 weeks. So it's always preferable to start 6 weeks if the area is suitable for radiotherapy. An entire postoperative bed should be covered, should be taken, especially in cases of EC. If level 2 is involved, please include retrostylite space up to the base of the skull. If level 5 lymph node is positive, include SCF node. When there is pathological lymph node abuts, invades a muscle, include muscle at least in the entire invaded level. In selected lymph node dissection, when few marginal nodes are affected, include adjacent nevals. So, and pharyngeal tumors, when node is positive, it's better to take lateral retropharyngeal nodes as a target. So when we talk about extracapsular extension, it has been seen that about 97% of EC remains in the 5 millimeter of margin. That's why giving 5 millimeter margin from the node is adequate, and you can actually cover 97% of extracapsular extension. So here, with the presence of extracapsular extension, you have to take the whole area 5 millimeter beyond the nodes, and you may include the muscles as well if muscles are involved. If we look at the outcome, local failure rates about 20-30 to 40-50%, distant failure around 25%, and survival 5 years rate is around 30-35% in locally advanced disease when radiation or adjuvant therapy is required. But in spite of adjuvant radiation, there are some cases where we need to add chemotherapy as well. So there are several studies have shown there are few criteria for which we need to add chemotherapy as well. So I am not going through all the studies, but these two are important. One is URTC and the other one is RTOG. So this is one meta-analysis. They combined both the studies and they took the common high-risk criteria of margin and EC, and they found addition of chemotherapy is beneficial for outcome in terms in positive margin and having extracapsular extension, and no other factors were determinant for outcome in overall survival. And with these two overalls, there are overall survival benefit of 12.5% if you add chemotherapy with your radiotherapy. But along with that, you have to keep in your mind that you may actually increase your toxicity to 70% from 30%. If you add chemotherapy, there are trials, they compared post-op versus pre-op radiotherapy, but this is a very pretty old trial and local regional control was better, but usually the standard of care nowadays is to offer post-operative radiotherapy, because it is also important to understand the histopathology of the primary disease. This is one important trial from TMH where 186 patients were randomized in three arms. One arm, they received radiotherapy alone. Other arm received accelerated radiotherapy, that is the radiotherapy for 6 days a week. And the other arm received CTRT. And they found actually no difference in these three arms. Though there are some caveats in this study, but probably in the adjuvant talk, Dr. Sarvani will tell you in details about this study and the limitations of this study. Another way we can tweak our efficacy of the radiotherapy, that is by doing altered fractionated radiotherapy. So conventional fractionation means 1.8 to 2 gray per fraction daily, one dose, 5 days a week for a period of 5 to 7 weeks. So here in altered fractionation, either we can change the total dose, we can use change, tweak the dose per fraction, we can change the interval between the fraction, or we can reduce the overall treatment time. And it also depends on the type of the tumor, in which tumor we should apply which kind of altered fractionation regime, and if I'm on its alpha beta ratio. And what we are dealing with, what are the acutely reacting normal tissue surrounding the tumor, what are the late reacting normal tissues surrounding the tumor. So in altered fractionation, if you look at this graph, this blue line actually it's a tumor control, and the red line is the normal tissue complication probability. So we want dose somewhere in between so that we can achieve adequate tumor control, but we should not have, or we should not give late complications to our patients. So, and our main idea for altered fractionation is, so actually increase the space between these two graphs. So actually we can improve tumor control by offering accelerated fractionation, or we can actually reduce the late complication by offering the hyperfractionation. So I must give this example of this meta-analysis, that March meta-analysis, which was published in 2006 in Lancet by Joe Buies. So there they have taken all the altered fractionated regimes and compared with the conventional regime, and have shown there is survival about 2.4%. Can everyone mute themselves? Yeah, thank you.
Sir, please unmute yourself. You are on mute mode. Please unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay. So in RTOG 9003 phase 3, here they compared four fractionated regime. One was conventional, one was hyperfractionated, other one accelerated and accelerated with concomitant boost. So loco region, there was improvement in loco regional control in favor of hyperfractionated and accelerated fractionation with boost regime. And even in the long term update, that holds true, that benefit was there in the hyperfractionation and concomitant boost group. And if you compare the adverse effects, it was comparable with the other arms, with the conventional arm as well.
So can and you please make it full screen?
Yeah. And this is the moderately accelerated regime trial. One was Danka 6, which was only glottic, and Danka 7 with all other sites with nimorazole. So even in this, there was improvement in local control, but there was no difference in the survival. This is our own study from TMH, the IAEA study, where they compared 6 fractions with 5 fractions a week. And here also they have found there is significant benefit in loco-regional control. And for our country, it's very important. For 6 fraction a week, actually we are saving 1 week in each patient from 7 weeks. So in a department of 30% head and neck cancer, we can save actually 30 weeks in 100 patients department in 7 week span. So by which actually we can accommodate 40 more patients of head and neck cancer. And to summarize the fractionation, the split course treatment is bad for tumor control. Prolongation of dose is bad unless the dose is corrected. Concomitant boost at the end of the treatment has an advantage to counter accelerated repopulation. Usually that occurs after the 3rd week of radiotherapy. Shorter treatment time has advantage if enough dose is delivered with manageable toxicity. Prolongation is okay if enough dose given to keep ahead of proliferation, and we have to protect the toxicity as well. Now let us discuss few about the addition of radiosensitizers. So to improve the efficacy of radiotherapy, we have tried to add radiosensitizer in form of chemotherapy. So concurrent chemotherapy is indicated in post-op RTF, we have already mentioned, in positive margin and EC. We know that concurrent chemotherapy can improve survival compared to radiotherapy alone in locally advanced head and neck cancers. We know that addition of EGFR inhibitors considered in those patients who are not suitable for concurrent chemotherapy. And for advanced nasopharyngeal cancer, addition of neoadjuvant therapy probably can improve outcome. So we will discuss these one by one. So let us start with nasopharynx. This is the one of the trial we used to follow always for treating nasopharynx, that is intergroup 0099. So where radiotherapy was compared with radiation plus chemotherapy, where chemotherapy was concurrent with adjuvant chemotherapy. And there was significant improvement in survival in favor of concurrent chemo radiotherapy followed by adjuvant radiotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy. And this is the meta-analysis of addition of chemotherapy, addition of new adjuvant chemotherapy, addition of concurrent chemotherapy. And we have seen that survival benefit in a tune of 20% in nasopharynx after 5 years. Now the question was whether to give induction or concomitant chemotherapy. So this is a recently published trial that induction chemotherapy plus concurrent chemoradiotherapy versus concurrent chemoradiotherapy alone in locally regionally advanced nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So where they have shown that there is improvement in failure-free survival and distant failure-free survival in favor of induction chemotherapy. So for nasopharynx, T1N0 disease, usually we treat with radiotherapy alone. T2N0 disease can be treated with concurrent chemoradiotherapy. For T3 onwards or N1 onwards, usually the standard of care now is giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by chemoradiotherapy. And if we look at the toxicity profile in that trial, so definitely neoadjuvant chemotherapy can cause higher toxicity compared to concurrent chemoradiotherapy alone in terms of higher grade 3 hematological toxicity and grade 4 hematological toxicity. Other toxicities are comparable. And this is the landmark meta-analysis, the MAC-NZ meta-analysis of non-nasopharyngeal cancers, where we have we know that there is improvement of 6.5% in 5 years survival in addition of concurrent chemotherapy with radiotherapy, and especially in those patients whose age is less than 70. And concurrent was more effective than induction or adjuvant chemotherapy. So we have tried intensification of our treatment by addition of targeted agents or biological agents. So this is a landmark Bonner paper where radiotherapy alone was compared with radiotherapy with cetuximab, and there was significant 5 years overall survival benefit in favor of radiotherapy plus cetuximab. So on the background of this Bonner trial, Kiang and actually developed our protocol RTOG 0522, where actually he added cetuximab with cisplatin to see whether addition of cetuximab with cisplatin can improve our outcome. But it was a negative trial because we have seen there is no difference in outcome in terms of progression-free survival, overall survival, or local regional control. But one important aspect we learned from this trial, because they actually kept their tissue in the tissue repository and they analyzed their HPV data. And when we look at the HPV data, so there was a significant difference in outcome in HPV positive versus HPV negative. Now why this HPV positive patients do well? Because we know in HPV positive patients, we see wild type of P53. So P53 is a kind of apoptotic promoter. So it activates apoptosis. So it also increase immune mediated clearance by anti-tumor immunity. It caused genomic instability of the tumor, and by which it caused impaired DNA repair after radiotherapy. And there is less tumor hypoxia and increased DNA fixation in those kind of tumors. So that's why usually we see better response in HPV positive patients. And HPV positive, they are usually younger patients. That's why when you compare HPV positive with HPV negative patients, HPV negative, those patients are, those tumors are more associated with smoking. those are elderly patients. That's why the outcome, and usually in those cases we see mutated p53, the outcome is worse than the HPV positive patients. So on basis of that, people have tried to de-escalate the treatment modality by the form of reduction of chemotherapy, by form of replacing chemotherapy with targeted therapy, by the form of reduction of the radiotherapy dose. But recently published RTOG 1016 and de-escalate trial have shown the negative results, which means still it holds true that for locally advanced disease, radiotherapy plus concurrent chemotherapy with cisplatin, preferably 3 weekly cisplatin, is still the standard of care. Even surgeons are trying to de-intensify the radiotherapy protocols. How? So for oropharyngeal cancers, they are trying to do surgery, and they are trying to actually divide in three groups, whether it's a low risk group, whether it's an intermediate risk group, or a high risk group. So for low risk group, they are offering for observations. For intermediate risk group, they are giving low dose of radiotherapy. For high risk group, definitely they are offering standard dose of radiotherapy. So recently published ORATOR data, which has shown that at 1 year, quality of life is actually worse in surgical arm compared to radiotherapy arm. And when a surgeon compare surgery versus radiotherapy, you always remember it is not comparison of surgery versus radiotherapy. It is comparison of surgery plus radiotherapy versus radiotherapy, because 80%, 70 to 80% of these patients actually require adjuvant radiotherapy after surgery. So this is important. We always come across some difficulties like hypoxia. And it, this hypoxia can be perfusion-limited acute hypoxia or diffusion-limited chronic hypoxia. And we have tried using hypoxic cells and sensitizers like misoprostol, nimorazole. So DANCA 5 actually looked at addition of nimorazole, whether improves survival compared to radiotherapy alone. Yes, addition of nimorazole can improve loco-regional control. And if you look at the P16 negative disease in our group of patients, usually we see 80 to 85% oropharyngeal cancer as a P16 negative patients. So there is higher chance of improvement in loco-regional control if you add a hypoxic modifier, especially in P16 negative patients. But there is no difference in P16 positive because we see less hypoxic area in P16 positive disease. This is one meta-analysis for all these hypoxic modifiers, and you can see this forest plot, this red diamond. So there is improvement in loco-regional control in favor of addition of hypoxic modifier. And they have classified hypoxic cells in two groups, more hypoxic and less hypoxic in DANCA 5. And if you compare those who had more hypoxic tumors, they had a better difference in survival with addition of nimorazole versus placebo. So in Danish group, the standard of care in their country is radiotherapy, cisplatin plus nimorazole in locally advanced cases. So as I said, there was they have people tried to reduce the dose of radiotherapy as well to the neck. But while prescribing the dose, we should always keep in our mind about the dose to the wearers. So there are some absolute priority like brainstem and spinal cord. We have to limit our dose within the threshold. there are some must where priority not necessarily above the target coverage. So where we give more priority to target coverage, like anterior eye, optic chiasm, retina. And there are some conditions where we should, where there is good evidence of sparing, like cochlea, parotid bands, mandible. And there are some area where we can, if we can, we should. That is pituitary gland, normal brain, submandibular glands, oral cavity, lips, pharynx, thyroid, and esophagus. So we come across a lot of acute complications of radiotherapy, like mucositis, dermatitis, altered absence of taste sensations, oral candidiasis, edema, pain, dysphagia, malnutrition, alopecia, and chemo-related toxicity. For this, it is very important to provide adequate supportive care while a patient is on radiotherapy. And these are the late complications that we face: xerostomia, fibrosis, dental caries. So for that, it is important to do pre-radiotherapy dental checkup for each and every patient. We see osteoradionecrosis if not a proper dental examination being done before starting of radiotherapy. We see edema, trismus, deafness, neuropathy, dysphagia, and stricture. So xerostomia can be substantially reduced by limiting the mean parotid dose to 26 to 30 gray, as it's preferably less than 26 gray. And for dysphagia, it is important to save or limit our dose to our constrictors. So less than 55 gray to the inferior constrictor muscles and maximum less than dose of less than 60 gray to cricopharyngeal sphincter. So we actually can achieve this in some cases by progressive conformation of dose. So we have gone through the conventional to conformal to IMRT for the same objective, to improve the tumor control and reduce the toxicity. So IMRT in head and neck cancer, actually, it's a robust mean to improve the dose delivery. And these are the several early reports of IMRT where we have seen improvement in xerostomia. This is the multi-institutional trial of hypofractionated intensity model. This is early IMRT phase 2 data, where we have seen the improvement in salivary functions. This is randomized data that IMRT was significantly greater than conformal radiotherapy in terms of salivary functions. This is a nasopharyngeal data. And this is the PASSPORT trial, where actually IMRT was compared or randomized with the conformal radiotherapy or conventional radiotherapy. So where there was no difference in overall survival or locoregional progression-free survival, but there was significant benefit in salivary gland toxicity or acute salivary toxicity, as well as late salivary toxicity. And if you look at the improvement in salivary function in IMRT, we can see the gradual improvement of salivary function up to the baseline. But where in the other conformal radiotherapy, we cannot see this kind of improvement in salivary function. And as I said, there is no difference in outcome. So we have our own data from TMH. There are two trials, Varian trial and Siemens trial. And so far we have 7 RCTs. And if you combine all those 7 RCTs, if you look at the acute grade 2 xerostomia, there is improvement in grade 2 xerostomia in favor of IMRT. There is improvement in late grade 2 xerostomia in favor of IMRT. There is no difference in loco-regional control, but there was a difference in loco-regional control in nasopharynx subgroup, but not in laryngopharynx subgroup. If we look at the overall survival, though there was a benefit of overall survival if we combine all those trials, but this improvement of overall survival because of this nasopharyngeal data, because it outweighs the other trials. So there is overall survival benefit in nasopharynx, but not in laryngopharynx in favor of IMRT. So only thing that is worse for IMRT, that is fatigue, because with IMRT we have seen higher dose in the cerebellum. And xerostomia specific quality of life better preserved with IMRT in all the studies. And if we look at the dose fractionation in IMRT, it is very variable from institution to institution. The target is to deliver around 66 to 70 equivalent dose. So I'm not going through details of this chart. And one question I always get from many person, even from radiation oncologist, which is the best system for head and neck IMRT? Probably this slide is the best answer for them. So if here they have compared dosimetrically all the systems, Varian, Siemens, Tomotherapy, Rapidac, Onco, Pinnacle, Step and Shoot, Dynamic MLC, and you can see the curves are bang on each other. So actually there is no difference. It is about selecting your patient properly and selecting your patient for IMRT. So as I said, it improves xerostomia, it decreases late xerostomia, and nasopharyngeal cancer stands to benefit most with IMRT. Proton, there is another class for proton. Dr. Dodul will discuss about proton and heavy ion therapy. If you have 5 to 10 minutes, I can discuss about the nodal levels. I'll not discuss about the contouring today, but the
okay,
nodal.
Please go ahead.
Okay, fine. So if how do we select neck nodes for radiotherapy? So we know that there are superficial group and there are deep groups. You please go through the Gregoire's classification and levels of lymph nodes. I'm not discussing each and every level. So whatever the evidence we have, let us see whatever the evidence we have in case of oral cavity. So this is data from TMH. So it's a data of 698 neck dissection. You can see that 91% nodal involvement was there in level 2, level 1 to level 3. So whenever we are treating oral cavity, we should emphasize targeting level 1 to level 3. And if you look at level 5, it is only around 4%. Level 4 is also around 5%. And upper level 5 also less. So oral cavity we have already discussed. So CTV node for oral cavity, usually we, for ipsilateral neck, we take 1, 2, 3, 4 for anterior tongue. Contralateral neck, same 1, 2, 3, 4. And usually we treat ipsilateral side for buccal mucosa. In case of nasopharynx, you see there is around for even for node negative, there is higher chance of 70% chance of involvement of level 2, 45% level 3. Level 5, it's 27%. So these are the important site to target for nasopharyngeal cancer. It is not 1B, it is around 3%. 6, only 0%. So these are the area we should target for nasopharynx. So for N0, N2, we should target 2 to 5 along with retropharyngeal. For N3 disease, same, and also take the adjacent structures according to clinical and radiological data. When we talk about oropharyngeal cancer, for ipsilateral, see, ipsilateral 82% for level 2, 23%. If we go to opposite side, it's 24% for level 2. That's why in oropharyngeal cancer, mostly we treat bilaterally. In N0, this is, there are some situations in even in oropharynx when we can treat unilaterally. This is very well lateralized tonsillar lesion where there is very less chance of contralateral failure, which is about 3.5%. Here, actually, we can get away with ipsilateral neck nodal radiation. So, purpose of ipsilateral neck nodal radiation is to decrease the morbidity due to radiotherapy. So, for oropharynx, same 2 to 4, and we should take retropharynx, retropharyngeal node. For N3 nodes, we should take adjacent structures as well, and we have to take contralateral neck nodes. Same with hypopharynx, there is higher chance of contralateral neck nodal metastasis. I'll give you these slides and with this num, so you can read it afterwards. So I'm not discussing each and every slides. And this is about larynx, where there is very less chance of neck nodal involvement when it is confined to vocal cord. But when it is beyond vocal cord, there is higher chance of involvement of bilateral neck nodes. So we need to include bilateral neck nodes. This is when we should take contralateral neck nodes. If we look at the oral TAM, when it is clinically neck nodal positive, N power plus 12%. So oral tongue, floor of mouth, BOT, these are the sites where bilateral involvement is more, pharyngeal walls, piriform sinus, supraglottic. Tonsil well lateralized, there is less chance of bilateral involvement, as I said. So unilateral neck treatment we consider for buccal mucosa, alveolus, retromolar trigone, and early lateralized tonsil. And for when should we treat retropharyngeal node? Nasopharynx, yes. Nasopharynx for N0, it is chance of getting involved is 40%. For when it is N plus, it is about 86%. In oropharynx, if you look as a whole, it is only 4%. But if you when you divide it by pharyngeal wall, soft palate, tonsillar fossa, it is very high in pharyngeal wall. So for pharyngeal wall, we need to take include the retropharyngeal nodes. So let us move. Risk stratification, there are several thoughts on risk stratification. Somebody, they divide it into two groups. One is high risk area and low risk. Some group, they divide it into three: high risk, intermediate risk, and low risk. That depends on the institutional protocol. And you see, I have already discussed delineation of nodal stations. You please go through these articles to understand the delineation and practices in your department. There is another important aspect, that is metastatic neck node from unknown primary. I am not going to discuss it because it's itself a topic for at least for half an hour. Just to make you aware of, it depends on whether that node, it's also important whether EBV positive or EBV negative, whether it's undifferentiated or it's a squamous cell carcinoma. So if it is EBV positive, undifferentiated, then there is a chance of nasopharyngeal cancer, then the treatment of choice is CTRT. In some other cases, actually, surgery can be considered and a decision can be taken after resection of the node based on the histopath and IHC of the node. There is one interesting data from Dhanka. They analyzed 277 patients of metastatic neck node from unknown primary. And they compared outcome for surgical series with the radiotherapy. And they proved the radiotherapy is significantly better compared to surgery. But take this with a pinch of salt, because you see the number. The only 23 patients had undergone surgery and rest actually received radiotherapy radiotherapy. So you cannot compare 220 patients with 23. So don't take this data seriously. And for CUCAP, so overall survival for radically treated patients around 51, 48, and 36%. That's neck control, disease-free survival, and overall survival. Oropharynx and hypopharynx, oral cavity most common. The other sites are lung, esophagus. We have to be keep in mind. And this is the post-neck dissection. If level 1 is only involved, when primary is unknown, you should include the oral cavity, wall death ring, oropharynx, bilateral neck. If level 2 and 3 involved, include oropharynx, bilateral neck. Level 4 only, then T2 wall death ring, larynx, hypopharynx, bilateral neck. Level 5 is involved, then larynx, hypopharynx, and bilateral neck. And 2-3 disease, we need adjuvant radiotherapy as well. And EBV positive, you need you have to opt for radical chemo radiotherapy. Recurrent disease and re-radiation will be discussed by Dr. Sarvani. I am not discussing it today. And to summarize the whole radiotherapy in one page, let us see whether I can do that. So basically, whatever we have discussed, we have understood that efficacy of chemo radiotherapy is definitely better than radiotherapy alone in terms of overall survival by McKenzie analysis. We know hyperfractionated radiotherapy or altered fractionation like or accelerated fractionations is better than radiotherapy alone. We know that from our IAEA data, RTOG data, Marsh meta-analysis. We know the efficacy of biologicals plus radiotherapy is better than radiotherapy alone from the Bonner trial. We know that EGFR biologicals plus chemotherapy plus radiotherapy is probably worse than chemo radiotherapy. That is from Kiang and data, RTOG data. We know that accelerated radiotherapy with chemotherapy is probably similar like radiotherapy plus chemotherapy from Dang data, from Danish data. Though I have not discussed it today, that will be discussed in larynx class, that efficacy of induction chemo radiotherapy for responders, it's from VA trials where they have used for induction chemotherapy and assess the response for very advanced laryngeal cancer, whether they are responders. If they are responders, they try to give chemo radiotherapy to preserve the organ. And actually, they have seen that by actually chemo selecting this patient or bioselecting this patient, we can preserve the organ and the outcome is similar like total laryngectomy plus radiotherapy. And we have understood that efficacy of induction chemotherapy TPF is better than induction chemotherapy with PF. I have not discussed today that tax 323-324. And efficacy of induction chemotherapy plus CTRT is similar to radiotherapy and chemotherapy, like in paradigm trial. Efficacy of induction chemotherapy followed by chemoradiotherapy is better than chemoradiotherapy alone in advanced nasopharyngeal cancer. And this is always true that early and late toxicity of radiotherapy plus anything, if you add biologicals, if you add chemotherapy or anything, is more than radiotherapy alone. So before adding any radio sensitizers, please be careful about your patient, whether your patient is fit for chemotherapy, whether is your patient is fit for biologicals, whether your patient is fit for other radio sensitizers, and always look at the data. The most of the trials have done with the patients of age group between 18 to 65 or 70, not beyond 65 and 70. And if you look at the difference in overall survival in all the trials, if you subgroup those difference as per the age group, you can see there is gradual decrease in the benefit of addition of radiosensitizer if you increase the age. So that is also important. And whenever we come to our real life data compared to the clinical trial data, the real life data is always, the difference is always less compared to clinical trial data, because in clinical trial, invariably we look after the patient with our best supportive measures much more better way compared to our day-to-day clinical practice. Though this is probably this should not happen, but this is true for most of the centers. So that's why you choose your patient appropriately for radiotherapy, choose your patient appropriately for advanced radiotherapy, and choose your radiosensitizer appropriately based on the patient, based on the data available, and based on the best of level of evidence. Thank you very much.